January 2nd, 2016, as we go full power here. Of course, right? We're not slowing down. We're going faster now. That's right. And just to set the stage, we're here in California, Bay Area. The sun has decided to disappear for quite some time here, maybe the next 15 days. We haven't seen it for quite some time. But yet, finally, the cold is dissipated. I'm able to actually be outside taping here. It's getting dark. And it's not so terrible. So that's fantastic. We expect a full week of rain, 2 to 4 inches. It's coming in 6 inches in the mountains. So a lot of rain, which is great for California because of the drought. And we're in this 5-month push because we want to be ready for some sort of ascensional situation by definitely by July of 2016 this year. There's a heads up. I've gotten a heads up, big time heads up, that we need to prepare. Now, it's really interesting that in the Bible, Jesus talks about preparing, preparing, preparing. You don't know when this coming is coming. You know, you never know when the owner of the house is coming back. You don't know when the wedding is. You got to be ready for the wedding. So all this preparing. He says trouble will come like a thief in the night. Like a thief in the night. Well, it's dark. You don't even see it coming. The thief hits you before you're even aware of it. So it's not like you get this long lead-up time to it where people say, oh, yeah, we see it coming, we see it coming, we see it coming, we see the trouble. It's not like that, at least scientifically, he's talking about. But, of course, if he was warning us, they said there must be a way to be aware of what's coming on because all is consciousness, all is awareness. So even an asteroid is awareness. It's all awareness. So the mind knows everything. The mind, Holy Spirit, has our best interests always in its mind, in the one mind, and we've tried to change what we are and denying that we're as we were created, so we pretend to be unaware. But all is awareness being aware of awareness. Awareness is aware of awareness. How could it not be? Could awareness be unaware of awareness? Is that possible? We're pretending it is. But awareness knows. So apparently, plausible inference, which is as much as we can really get here in this realm of perception, in this dream of perception, plausible inference is that there is some event, something happening in July of 2016. And instead of getting all freaked out, just the opposite of saying, okay, great, this is a great motivation to really focus in. Just like the rain, we said there's a plausible inference there's some rain coming. Now we say plausible inference because it seems like about 90% of the time the meteorologists get it wrong. They've been just atrocious recently, just atrocious. Today was supposed to be a beautiful sunny day. It was a terrible overcast cloudy day, although not quite as cold as before. So they can't seem to get it right, but the National Weather Service is saying this storm, 3 storms are coming. We have the satellites, we have the jet stream. It is coming, it is coming. So we say, you know what? Let's give plausible inference to this. Not certainty, not knowing, plausible inference. So when we say that there's some event that could happen in July, it's plausible inference. I'm not saying I know or am certain about this. I've been getting a lot of indications, plausible inference. Heads up, heads up, heads up. Something is coming our way. And so we just continue our preparations for what? Well, as I've said, the Holy Spirit will pay us to be safe. How about that? Paying us to be safe. Now, this may come, maybe where the whole idea in Christianity comes from. Jesus ransomed us from sin or something like that. Yeah, that may be what they have tried to be saying. It just didn't quite come out. The ego kind of went through the egoic lens a bit and got distorted. The ego's paying us to die, to be imperiled, because we want to be imperiled. We think imperilment will change our will motivate us. So our will change through imperilment. And so we are, in essence, paying ourselves through this imaginary intermediary, the ego, the false mind, pretend mind, to reward us for imperilment. So we got a world, hey, we've got bodies that can be imperiled. We've got a world that can be imperiled. We'll take care of the bodies. We'll feed the bodies. We'll make sure that you get your imperilment. Well, the Holy Spirit says, I'll pay you to not be imperiled. So maybe this is the paying the price, the ransom price, like we're being held ransom. It's just, it's a metaphorical way of speaking. And so the Holy Spirit will pay us to be safe, pay us to be well, pay us to not die, pay us to be blissful, pay us to abide in non-dual awareness. And so what we need to do is to go all in with that. Now, we played this little game yesterday of being the New Year's Day, is that the idea was everyone has to select one word that describes their new year, what they want to be, what this new year is all about for them. One word. So we went around and said, oh, someone said this, someone said that, someone said that. And they said, what about you? And I said, focus. I want to be focused. And then I thought, that's it. So, well, now let me say commitment. Commitment. And they said, which one? I said, commitment. Commitment is the word. And I feel great about that. This is the year of commitment. Okay, 2016 is the year of commitment. This is a spiritual declaration. Year of commitment. This is when we commit. Now, I know everyone's afraid of commitment, but if you've really prepared well, it's not so frightening. So I'm feeling this sense of commitment. Commit, commit, commit. Commit to the Holy Spirit. Commit to one or the other. Full commitment here. Let's not go keep bouncing back and forth. If we're going to be paid to be safe, let's commit to that and say, okay. Now, of course, this world is going to present a vast imperilment, likely. Plausible inference, that's likely. It's going to prevent a vast excuse for futility, for failure, which is what we want. Spirit wants that. Doesn't really want it, but it wants it because this enables it to continue to pretend it can change reality. And it's just, the failure is, well, these bodies are part of spirit and they failed. And they you know, these problems came upon the world and bodies. Well, no problems can come upon spirit at all. So it has to imagine that there's these bodies and worlds, impermanent, vulnerable to dying and suffering, etc. In order to claim, well, there's the failure. There's the failure. It's not with spirit trying to change, do the impossible. It's that part of spirit failed, so we have to pick up the pieces and try again. It's just like that. And so we don't need that. We don't need that. So we can commit to not doing that. Commit to not having this excuse. Now this is, it seems a little scary. It is. It feels a little scary. Just feeling it. It's like, wow. Because all the rest of the spirit will have this excuse. And we think, well, I don't have that excuse. So it does bring up some inner fear. There's no question about it. I'm feeling it right now. Sort of the stomach seems clenched, like, wow, do I really want to not go through imperilment and have this terrible excuse that seems so effective to fail? Because then we'll face God and say, God, I'm the one who failed to change what you are, thinking that God told us to change God, when God did not. So, but we don't want to be a failure. We don't want to face God as a failure. But actually, we do want to face God as a failure. We want to celebrate our failure and say, rejoice and say, hey, God, I failed to change what you are. I failed to change what I am. I failed to change reality. Isn't that wonderful? Aren't I happy? Isn't this great? What a celebration. Let's celebrate this wonderful failure, this inherent failure. So this is the way to flip the script and look at it. Let's celebrate this wonderful failure. So here we go, and so far so good. Now, so we know the storm is coming in. We know this wet pattern is coming in. The next 15 days look like it's going to be rain just about every day, or showery. It's a wet pattern. So we infer that, possibly infer that. What do? We get ready for it here. We get ready for it. So that's what I did today. The Thursday was all out inside, some outside, and then today was all out outside. And we located a few problematical spots that needed to be located and taken care of, and we are ready. We are ready for storms, for inclement weather, for a tremendous amount of precipitation. All right, let it come. Let it come. I finished all these preparations. So this shows how we can, when there is some impending trouble, use that as an impetus to get a lot done. Use it as an impetus to get a lot done. So it can be a very good thing. And if nothing happens, we've still gotten a lot done. You can't lose when you do it this way. You cannot lose. Bound to win no matter what happens. That's a pretty wonderful, very wonderful opportunity then. We're bound to win. Because the more we put effort into preparation, which Jesus was very big, saying you need to prepare for those times, the end times, the more we do that, the closer we get to accepting commitment, non-dual commitment, non-dual abidance commitment, which is fantastic. It is wonderful. Now, I am, where was I yesterday? Oh, I was in a restaurant. And I've been thinking about the Holy Spirit, how the Holy Spirit's going to pay everyone to be well, to be safe. And I envision that as like a beautiful golden light around everyone. That this is a commitment, the promise the Holy Spirit has made, that everyone is safe. And the Holy Spirit will always honor its commitment. Any instant that anyone chooses to commit to the Holy Spirit, to accepting its offer, to be paid, to be safe, this tremendous payment, this beautiful golden light, this great richness will come up, will be there for them. So I envision that then means that there's this beautiful richness around everyone, around the whole world, around everything, you might say. And I started looking at the people in the restaurant like that way. And I got this sort of spiritual feeling like, wow. I sort of got this feeling of what it's like to commit to the Holy Spirit and accept its payment. Is that you literally will see this richness around everyone, realizing that nobody is forsaken, not even for one instant. And that anyone, at any instant, can be enriched by the Holy Spirit, and all suffering, imperilment, all of that will disappear, be replaced with richness, with safety, with bliss. And I felt this very literally, that it is possible to see this, to see the Holy Spirit's offer, to actually see it being extended to everyone, so that you realize, oh, it's not just me, everybody has this offer. So I don't feel special, I don't feel guilt about accepting it, others don't have this, Holy Spirit is picking and choosing. No, you literally see it's extended to everyone. So this might be the vision of oneness, the vision of Christ that we're talking about here. I said, wow. Right. I said, wow. Didn't say yes, didn't say no. I said, wow. So this is the benefit we have here with full stop and the wow, is we can just say wow right off the bat. And that's eloquence. That's great expressiveness. That's hitting the mark perfectly. Wow. I mean, whether we take it or not, just the idea is, it's just a huge wow. That the Holy Spirit is never off-put one bit by all of our delay in choosing the ego's way. Is always right there for us to accept. And will always be. It will always be. Right there for us to accept. Wow. And no catastrophe could change that in the slightest bit. So no one is lost, no one is forsaken. So this might change, this is likely to change our attitude greatly. Now we don't see this, why? Because we're choosing the ego. And the ego says, there's nothing there to see. The ego claims, it's the only offer there is. There is no other. You're crazy if you think there is. So we don't want to be crazy in the ego's, from the ego standpoint, so we pretend not to be aware of this. Pretending to not be aware. How about that? When we ask ourselves, well, how do we see the light? How do we see this richness? Well, stop pretending that we can't see it. Stop pretending that we can't see it. When we put the whole thing on pretending, this changes our equation, the spiritual equation. Irrevocably changes it, doesn't it? It's not some quantifiable process that we're dealing with at all. How is pretense quantifiable, actually? How is it a process, actually? Can we not stop pretending instantly if we want to? Isn't that the whole notion, meaning of the term pretense? Am I, you know, I'm pretending that I can't see, and then say, oh, now I see. I want to see, so I see. The whole idea, yeah, is pretense. We're fully in control of it entirely, and there isn't any real process involved in pretense. Nor is there any time involved, nor space involved, time space involved at all. So there's nothing we have to wait on to stop pretending. So we're pretending that we cannot see the Holy Spirit's offer of richness. All we do is stop pretending. So again, we can see how this changes the whole spiritual equation, the spiritual path, the equation. It's just like, wow, this is very, very different. And again, another wow. And just let the wow get hit by the wow. Because in doing so, next time we consider this, the reaction will not be, probably not be nearly as strong. Or we'll feel, oh, this feels comfortable. I had this reaction before, so I know I got through it fine. So I'm not bothered, I'm not concerned. And this is how it works. The great, oh, I've done this before, been here before, is like a miracle for us. It knocks out all of the thinking and concern and figuring out, etc., etc. We say, I've been here before. No problem. There's only one golf course right now in the world I really want to play. But I've been there. I can say, well, yeah, I've been there. Been there before. So I know I can do it. I feel plausible inference that I can go there again. Certainly want to. I really do. But like the first time, you're thinking, you're all nervous. I mean, just doing all sorts of stuff that you normally don't do. But if you've been there before and you're comfortable, just okay, it's just like an old friend. Not a problem here. And you're relaxed. You don't make mistakes. You're more focused, more committed to what you're doing, like that. So it's exactly like that. The miracle of spiritual path is familiarity. And it seems as though most are searching for something else, like some formula, which is what? Magic. Magic is all about incantations and rituals and formulas and figures and, you know, get this magical quantitative equation and this will bring about enlightenment and such. No, the key is familiarity. It's familiarity that's decisive. Now I got that shirt that I ordered, and it fits great. It's awesome. It's exactly what I wanted. Came really fast too. Really, really fast. It initially said it was going to take quite some time, like 11 days or something, and it came just like in a couple days. It's amazing. Of course, it came from nearby, I found out, the shipping. So I'm wearing it right now, and it fits perfect. Everything's perfect. But I'm still like, wow. It's like, wow. But, of course, next time I wear the shirt, I'll feel much more comfortable. And after wearing it several times, you get used to it, and it's just like, oh, I feel totally comfortable. It's like clothes that you get comfortable with. You know you're going to feel good. You're going to move good. Everything is fine. It's like that. You get used to your clothing. Very similar. This, we're talking about spiritual clothing here, but it's quite similar. So whenever you put on new clothes, you feel a little not sure of yourself, and a little bit, you know, is this right? Does it look good? Does it feel good? Is it everything? You know, it's like, I'm a little bit nervous. But once you wear it, like a pair of shoes, you wear it, then you get so used to those pair of shoes. You say, I know I can put on these pair of shoes. I know what I can do with the shoes. I know how they're going to feel, how they're going to react, all this stuff. So familiarity is what wins. It's what's decisive. And of course, the only way to get familiarity is to actually do it and wear the clothes. You can't get familiar with clothing by just looking at it. It's like, imagine you get some clothing and you just hang it up. Just every day, just kind of look at it. Wow. You got to put the clothing on and feel it. So this is what we do. We put the spiritual clothing on of these ideas and get used to them. And the more more we get used to them, the easier it is for us. Now, I did mention several videos back. I feel I have at least maybe a little value. I say, well, maybe. You say, plausible inference. Let's say plausible inference, I have some value. So let's not, don't try to go any further than plausible inference. This is where you start to feel shaky and then the ego can take charge. When we put it just all in plausible inference, this really knocks the ego out. It really does. This is maybe one of the most important recognitions. Because when I just went and say, well, I know that I have some value, I started feeling nervous. Because I don't really know. I can't say that in this dream of perception. So I said, well, I think I do. That's still, I feel very jittery, not on solid ground, but I say, there's a lot of plausible inference. There's plausible inference, let's say, that I have some value. I see some plausible inference that I have some value. Then I feel like sort of calm and comfortable, say, yeah, that's a fair enough statement to make. Now, why do I have some value? Plausible inference that I have some value is that I feel like I could be like a protege of one of these teachers, very, very great teachers, a protege sort of situation. Now, it sort of feels, here's an example, like go and play golf with Tiger Woods, for instance. Well, right now he can't play very well, but in his heyday, let's say, and older people, you can say Jack Nicklaus or whatever, whoever. Who would have the guts to do that? You know, most of the pros were intimidated, very intimidated. They couldn't play their game. Their game fell apart. So I would say, well, if I played golf with Tiger Woods, my game would fall apart for sure, I would think. It's like, oh my gosh, I'd forget about what I'm doing and watch him. But I feel like, sure, my game would fall apart, but I wouldn't fall apart. I'd just say, okay, what did I notice? Well, how can I get more professional? How can I improve my professionalism and commitment and get better? And then let's play another round. And I feel, you know, I might struggle some more, but I might get a little better. And I wouldn't give up. I wouldn't give up. I keep doing it. And I feel ultimately I'd be way, way better for doing this. That I would not fall apart and quit golf and say, ah, there's no way I can be that good. Forget it. My game's terrible. I'm horrible. Ah, I can't stand the comparison of being so awful. I would say that. I'd embrace it. I'd say, this is great. This is great. This is going to bring out the best in me. Ultimately. So this is like being a protege. This is the attitude one has to have. Because obviously, protege is means someone is in the company of and studying under someone who's very expert. And so, of course, there's going to be this feeling like, wow, I'm with someone who's such an expert, I can't even hardly relate with this at all. So it's not easy to be a protege. This is why we wonder, well, why don't these great teachers have all these protégés? Because it's very difficult to have all these protégés. Here's an example. I give this before. Bubba Watson, really, really great golfer. I met him at Pebble Beach when he first came out on tour. I said, Bubba, I think you had a great game. I wish you all luck. I'm wishing you great success on the tour. And he said, wow, thanks a lot. And I had a little talk with him. He signed a hat. And well, he's become one of the top players in the world and maybe become number one in the world. But what he's done is he played a lot of golf with Tiger Woods. He insisted on it. And he says, very intimidating. But he's so creative and so good, it did not ruin him. It didn't ruin him. It's made him a lot better, you know, a whole lot better. So he was like sort of like a protege in that way. He had the talent, but not the great professional polish. And so he realized, hey, why don't I play with the best, and this will help me become the best. But most tour players, it ruins their game. That they just feel, wow, this is just too much. I can't do this. What? I'm not at that level, and it sort of demoralizes them. So these experts don't have a lot of protégés. They do not. Not a lot of us sign up for this. And the key is this wow reaction that we've been emphasizing, taking it as a wow. This is great. Wow, this is great. So if I hit an idiot shot with Tiger Woods, I was playing, and I'd say, wow, that was a great idiot shot I just hit. Wonderful idiot shot. Awesome. I really played like an idiot beautifully there. And then just keep this positive reinforcement going. And then I hit a decent shot. Wow, that was a really good decent shot, a really good amateur shot there. And then eventually I'll hit a really good pro shot. Say, wow, this is a really awesome pro shot I just hit right there. And then maybe I'll go hit another idiot shot and say, all right, I could still hit those great idiot shots. That's wonderful. And just keep this relentless positivity going. I believe that this is sort of what a protege needs to do. Otherwise, they're going to get down on themselves and say, wow, I just hit the most stupid idiot shot possible. Or maybe I just whiffed, you know, just, it's a great whiff, a great idiot whiff right there. That's the way to say it. Let me hold that finish of that idiot whiff. I completely missed the ball. And that can happen, too. You try to swing too hard, you're going to miss the ball entirely. Tiger Woods hits a 380 out there, and you say, oh, I got to really hit this, and you'll miss it. You say, well, that's an awesome, great idiot whiff right there. Love it. Love it. And so you just stay overflowing with positivity. And you don't get down. You don't get down on yourself. So there is a key to being a protege. It seems like we found the key to being a protege here. If you say something stupid, you say, wow, that was a great stupid statement. What a wonderful idiot statement I just made. Wonderful idiot action right there. Awesome. I'm very good at being an idiot right there. I just showed how good I am at pretending to be an idiot. Because this is all pretense after all anyway. So you just say, look, what an awesomely creative job I just did at being an idiot. Virtually perfect idiot right there. We make light of this, but not true light. We don't make true light of this, meaning we don't dismiss the true light behind what we're saying. In fact, we stay in the light of, yeah, we're not dismissing it by being humorous about it and laughing. We're saying, yeah, this is great. Yes. Wow. I like this. So we can say, yeah, I've led a great idiot life. Wow, what a wonderful, impeccable idiot life I've led. It's awesome. Awesome, impeccable idiot life. And then we might say, well, I'm going to maybe lead a really great amateur life now instead of an idiot life. Amateur being sort of like golf, a good amateur means you can play really well. You might even be single digit handicapper. You're good, but you're still an amateur. You're still an amateur. You can't hang with the pros on tour. But so you can say, hey, I want to have a really good amateur life, really impeccable amateur life. This then raises your game up. And realizing sometimes you'll decide, I'm going to go back to being, make sure I can still be an idiot. Okay, great, I can be an idiot. Wonderful. And at some point you might say, let me dabble in being a pro here for a little bit. And you dabble in being a pro and say, wow, that's a great pro action, great pro move right there. And you might say, okay, I want to go back to being an amateur. I say, wonderful amateur move there, wonderful amateur statement, great. Then maybe back again to the idiots. I want to feel like an idiot again. Let's do the idiot thing. I can still do the idiot thing. Wonderful. Wonderful. Because it's all pretense. And so we're afraid of leaving what we're our pretense. So we just reinforce, that's great. However we want to pretend is okay. It's okay. And gradually we'll gravitate towards being a real pro in understanding and recognizing all this. And recognizing that we don't need time, space, processor form to change our pretending. We don't need any of that. Process is pretense. Process is all pretending. And so is time, space, processor form. That's all dream, an hallucination, pretending. But of course, we are so into it that we insist, no, I'm not pretending. I'm stuck here. I'm in prison by this. It's not true. So, protege, becoming a protege, how to be a protege. So I hope I get this experience. I must be working towards it. Like I had that experience with these two very excellent, intimidating golfers that I don't know even how they hit the ball like that. Just wow. And my game completely fell apart. but I came away with it very positive. I didn't stick with them after 9 holes, but because I was like, saying, wait a minute, let me see if I can play better than this. I was kind of like worried, and I didn't, because my game had just been, my confidence has just been rattled so bad. So I probably should have just stayed with them. What the heck? Why not? Next time I will. Because I'm enjoying this. This is wonderful. I'm enjoying playing like a complete idiot. This is amazing. I didn't know I could still play like a complete idiot. It's been a long time since I played like this. But I still got it. You know, I still got it. literally do this. I've literally have done this. And the next time I went out, I did this, you know, the positive, 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 positive. No negatives. Didn't matter what I did. And I started to get mad at myself. I said, like, that, what an idiot shot. What, how, I said, wait. I said, wow, what a great idiot shot. I love that idiot shot. That's exactly what I wanted to do. I wanted to do this really lousy idiot shot. So I claimed ownership of it. I said, no, that's exactly what I was aiming for there. I wanted to hit an idiot shot, and I did just perfectly, just the way I wanted it. And no matter what shot I hit, I insisted that's exactly the way I wanted to hit it. No excuses. And amazingly, things worked out really well. It's hard to explain. And some of the idiot shots I hit, actually, I said, hey, that's not a bad place to be, actually. I can make this work pretty well. So, take complete ownership of our lives. So this is, you know, I did that. I did it exactly, things going exactly the way that I want them to go. So, this goes back to Lazy Man's Guide to Enlightenment. Is love it the way it is. Love it the way it is. Daddy is goalless. A lot of us in the 60s believed that he was onto something, and I still believe this. And he later kind of recanted and said, wow, maybe I didn't really say much of anything. This is what I believe. I believe I read that he kind of said, wow, maybe that wasn't it. No, I believe he was really onto something. Love it the way it is. No matter how it is, love it. So I just love it. This is exactly what I wanted. Yeah, it's exact suffering I wanted. Great cancer I have here. Wonderful cancer. This is a really deadly cancer. Wonderful deadly cancer. It's exactly what I wanted. Wonderful. Really happy about it. And then, and this somehow then enables you to shift your pretending to something else. Because the more we attack our pretending, the more we cling to it. If you say, oh, terrible cancer, how'd that happen? God is terrible, the world's terrible, I'm terrible, fate is terrible, oh, I didn't want this, who wants that? No, flip the script entirely, say, that's exactly what I was aiming for, and I hit it exactly. Isn't that wonderful? Look how creative I am. Look how on point I am. Look how perfect I am. I got exactly what I wanted. Spot on. Isn't that wonderful? So insist that whatever happens is spot on what you really want to happen. What was that? okay. It's spot on, exactly how you want it to happen. And just relentlessly keep insisting upon this. I really believe, wow. It's very heavy to say this because it's been a lot of years since then. Maybe published at, what, the early 70s or late 60s? It was a huge, huge bestseller. I think he started maybe in San Francisco, wrote it, and somewhere lived in San Francisco or something. And here we are, all these years later, and you know he could have been right. He could have literally found a shortcut. Now, in my opinion, he took a lot of drugs, apparently. I don't want to put words into, say he did or did not, but as I understand it, this came from psychedelics, a lot of this. But in my opinion, if that was the case, that was actually just a way to pretend that he didn't necessarily really know this already within his being. it was he didn't want to. He had this answer, but didn't want it to seem like he was the guy. You know, here's the answer. So he said, well, I took these drugs and I saw this and everything. And so people would say, oh yeah, you know, this is an excuse. You know, this is how I got it. So you know, it gives this plausible wiggle room inference kind of situation, but he probably just had this already within him. And he just had to find some way to fit it into the culture. But in doing so, that it also gave wiggle room for people to dismiss it. Well, it says, well, that was drug-induced and, yeah, blah, 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 blah. But, interestingly enough, here we are, 40 years later, or more, right? What, 70, 80, 90, 100, 45 years later or more, here we are talking about it. And saying, hey, wait a minute. So you see how people can help others, even though there seems to be a time lapse in it. It sank in enough to say, maybe he's right. Maybe this is true, that's what we're hearing. But I never applied it because it seems so crazy, right? And I didn't apply it until I had this experience with these two golfers dressed in black. These very intimidating, good Lord, they were intimidating. Big, powerful, you know, 20-something men with beards and drow dressed in black and just crashing the ball. Dropping in parachutes right next to the flag. You know, just like, whoa, what is this? What did I get myself into? And I fell apart so terribly. And then the next time I went golfing, I had to get my confidence back. And the Holy Spirit suggested, why don't you just start praising every shot you make? And I try it. And I started trying it. And things became sort of miraculous. Everything worked out great. I ended up chipping the ball in from 30 yards out or something. Just par. Oh, okay, great. So, well, that's a great pro shot right there. And I just went on the next one. Okay. Yeah, wonderful pro shot. Great pro shot. But I said, okay, but if I hit the next shot to an idiot shot, it's also a great idiot shot. So I can't lose. I can't lose. So what Thaddeus Golis was saying was that there's some, he discovered there's some sort of dynamic that if you don't love what is, then you end up being stuck with it somehow. You know, you're trying to figure out what the dynamic is. Well, I think it's not quite that. The explanation, I couldn't quite go with this explanation, but I sort of felt that what he was saying was accurate in terms of practicing this. We have a slightly different explanation here, which may be better, maybe not, but... it's the wow thing. It's the wow thing and the pretense and the continuity fear. And we're not going to let go of what protects us from continuity fear until we really feel that our creativity can provide us something better. Because we think we've harmed what we are and our creativity is out of whack. And so we say, well, at least I'm familiar with this being an idiot. And it seems kind of stable. It seems to be stable. So maybe the light's just an idiot now, and this is the way the light is. So my only option is to become familiar with being an idiot. And that's safe. We think that we've harmed the light, that the light is no longer the way that it used to be. And it's now an idiot. So we're very frightened to let go of our idiocy. And yet when we want to let go of our idiocy a little bit, we struggle, very much struggle. So what we do is we insist that our experiencing, our idiocy, is exactly what we ask for, without down to the very, very last nub. I mean, it is exactly what we ask for, and it's been beautifully presented and expressed. And this day before, we thank you, light. It was wonderful. Exactly what I wanted. Great, great, great idiot experiencing here I'm having. Thank you, light, and thank the light for it. So what this does, it restores our confidence in the light that it really hasn't changed, because the light is pretending that it's changed, even though it hasn't. So we have this awkwardness, okay? We have this awkwardness, and so we have to practice the practice allowing for this awkwardness and recognizing and I'm getting some interesting interference there. Perfect interference in the video. I know where it's coming from. That's great. So own it. Own everything that's happening to you completely. And not only own it, say, yeah, this is terrible. Why am I doing this? Say, no, this is exactly what I've been asking for. This is wonderfully on point. Don't say, oh, yeah, well, I love suffering. But say, no, this is wonderfully... This is a wonderful expression of being an idiot. Idiot suffering. It's a very clear, precise, beautiful expression of idiot suffering here. Thank you, Light, for giving me exactly what I asked you to give me. Now, you see, what this does, it restores our faith in the Light. It restores our faith. We have to restore our faith in the Light. Otherwise, we don't have a prayer. We do not have a chance. We really don't. So we're afraid that if we praise our suffering or praise that the Light will say, oh, you like being an idiot, go good, because that's all I can do, you know. But it's not like, so we have to have some faith in understanding that this is all pretense because we asked for it. Otherwise, then I can understand, we'd be too afraid to do this. But I'm not too afraid now at this point to do it this way. I say, no, I know that I asked Light to provide this nightmare, pretending that it's changed. So it's doing a great job doing that, but it hasn't changed. Just as I can pretend to be crippled and then suddenly stop pretending, just because I appear to be crippled doesn't mean I am. I'm pretending. So the Light is not crippled. The Light is not crippled. The Light is not crippled. And so we have to get past this awkwardness. There's a little awkwardness here. And I felt like a little odd there in the golf course, you know, just hitting the ball terrible. And I said, wow. Yes, you know, I get off the tee and slice it out of bounds. I said, yes, lost ball, great lost ball. I was just like, I did that immaculately. I couldn't do that better if I tried again. It was perfectly done. I really, really hit it great out of bounds there. It's in the poison oak. Wonderful, you know, wonderful idiot shot into the poison oak. Love it, love it. Well, if you're playing with someone else and you hit a shot like that and you're going, yes, they're going to say, this guy's kind of crazy. You just hit it out of bounds, didn't you? I say, absolutely. Well, you weren't trying to. So absolutely I was. I wanted to hit a great idiot shot, and I did hit it perfectly. And they're going to go, okay, maybe I need to, maybe you can just play through. I'm gonna wait a little while here. This thing just keeps... So it might be better, you know, if you're not not doing that in company. But if people can roll with that, then you know you're with some very great spiritual company. Really. I feel in some ways that like psychedelics and drug movement is just an excuse we're using. The people really have enlightenment is dawning upon them, but the culture is such, and the whole awkwardness of the situation is such that they need an excuse to say, so no, it's the drugs that are doing it. And then everyone kind of relaxes and says, oh, great, we thought it might actually be legit. So no, it's just a drug-induced experience. Oh, okay. So I feel that people come here with a lot of spiritual truth, and then they get this massive, the situation here, egoic situation here, which is denying truth completely, extreme pretense and all defensiveness of it, and they feel, wow, how am I going to fit in here? You know, what can I do? I have all this, you know, clarity that the world says is insanity. So they say, well, let me take some drugs, and then I can always say, well, blame it on the drugs. And it sort of enables them to fit into the world. I feel there's a lot, there could be some very strong legitimacy to this point. Because a lot of people taking drugs are actually very spiritual people. And I find that, I feel that they're trying to, again, use this as an excuse so they'll feel a little more comfortable in this world. Because without drugs, you got no excuse. You'd say, wow, it's got to be very disciplined. So I call all the people who are using drugs, spiritual people, I say, you don't need drugs. You don't really need them. But as long as you don't practice and are not disciplined, you will probably feel you need them. This is the issue, right? So there's no condemnation here about drugs. I'm just putting in the right context of what they're really about. You don't need drugs to have insight at all. You don't need drugs to know the truth. And ultimately, they kind of detract because it becomes sort of a social crutch, and you lose confidence in yourself because you start believing your own myth about these drugs are inducing the experience. Before, you probably knew, oh no, they're not really, but I just need this crutch here. But after a while, you start believing that, hey, that's where it's coming from. And it's not. It's not coming that from that. It's coming from the light. All light is 100% pure light. So there is a way to get off drugs, actually. And I believe spiritual teachers, those who have truly succeeded at whatever it is, however we want to define what we're aiming at here, they're very helpful to ultimately get help people get off drugs. Because people become more disciplined and they say, wow, it really is within me. It's not within the drug, actually. And they take ownership of their truth, ownership of truth. Don't give ownership of truth over to drugs. Say, no, the truth is within me. If you screw up, I'm the one who's doing the screw up perfectly. I ask the light for this screw up, and everything is functioning exactly the way I asked for it. I'm immaculately creative here. So everyone is actually being immaculately creative right now. There are no screw ups, actually. There are no screw ups at all. Everyone is being immaculately creative. Perfectly creative, right at this very moment. This is the case for everyone. So we have gotten somewhere, really. We really have. I'm just having this clarity of looking back and saying, wow, I can sort of see the overall panorama. That's you know, excellent. Dawning of truth, however you want to define it. There's lots of different ways we can define it. So sometimes I just say, well, however we want to define it. Beep, beep, beep. We don't have to always pin it down in a particular way, right? Because right now we're in the wow. We don't want to struggle trying to define what we're aiming at. Because we're very much in the wow. Maybe at least all the shifts you're seeing on the video, if you're seeing those, I'm certainly seeing them as I'm watching this or taping it. Maybe that's indicating a shift, sudden shift into less pretending. Or pretending in a different way, pretending to give in a way that gives plausible inference that light is still perfectly perfect, still immaculate, 100% pure, immaculate perfection. Giving us exactly the experience that we want. Trouble here in this world is we keep thinking, well, we can't, the light must be messed up real bad because look at all the terrible experience that we have. This is the inference that this world gives. The plausible inference is that light is gone crazy. But we are pretending. We ask for all this. Light has not gone crazy in the slightest bit. But it's understandable how looking at this world we could have plausible inference that it has. This is why we need reason here. Because if we just keep going on what our sensory information is telling us, we're going to plausibly infer the light has gone crazy. So the Holy Spirit brings reason and says, look at this through the eyes of reason, through the eye of reason, the single eye of reason, as it were. Look at it through that, and this is a different way of looking at it, and you say, wow, maybe what you're saying is true. Maybe we do have a continuity fear. Maybe we do have this, you know, this plausible inference, this insidious plausible inference causing awkwardness. Maybe we and we do have this arrogance problem, continuity fear problem, all this stuff. And reason shows us that this is a better explanation for our situation. But without that better explanation, we're going to keep floundering and go more and more into roboticism and automation and artificial intelligence, hoping that is going to save us. Automate the light. So yeah, the light's gone crazy, but we can automate it so it will be stably crazy. We don't want it changing back to not being crazy. You know, we're so used to the light being crazy now. We got to make sure it remains that way, but we'll eventually be able to adapt to it and, you know, get some nice free energy sources and be able to hunker down here and have our popcorn and movie and call it good. By the way, the situation, I couldn't hardly sleep last night. I was so worried of the potential of a disastrous situation. I put it in the hands of the Holy Spirit. I said, okay, you take care of it, Holy Spirit. I'm not going to worry about it. And I finally went to sleep. Well, the situation was the smoothest breeze you could imagine. It was amazing. My gosh. Everyone was super nice to us. Super efficient. Boom, 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 boom. Thank you very much. It was like the easiest situation ever. And this is a place that the review said this is the worst place ever. These people will just drive you nuts. They're so terrible. Well, we were treated like royalty. I mean, we were treated perfectly. I was just like, I got out of there. And I driving home, I could hardly drive. I just said, wow, what happened? I was expecting something horrible. It was just the opposite. Because I went in there with a feeling that everybody is completely blessed by the Holy Spirit, without any question about it, and always will be. And I said, I'll just let the Holy Spirit take care of all of this. And people were just so efficient and so nice, like they were expecting me. Oh, great, okay, yeah. Here's someone we like, and we'll take care of. I don't know. It's really astonishing. So it's a great experience. I decided to try this out because this was an amazing experience. This business has the worst Yelp reviews I've ever read. They make it seem like you're descending into hell by going there. Nightmare. Absolute nightmare. People are just furious with this place. And I was really scared because I had a situation where I was, if things go bad, I'm in big trouble. And yet it was totally the opposite because I put it in the hands of, I said, Holy Spirit, this is your deal, not mine. I'm not going to do anything. I'm just going to walk around looking like I'm a trillionaire or something. And just be confident. I just walked in. I'm just confident. Like, hey, everything. I said, everything's going to work out great for me. I know everything's working out great for everyone here. So this is sort of a confidence you have. And somehow people picked up on the confidence. Everybody's smiling and everybody's happy. Just wow. It was quite astonishing experience. But I put it to the test. A great test to put the Holy Spirit to the test here. Because I decided I didn't want a story. He said, this is what happened. If things went all wrong, guess what? I could have had this big story to tell friends and tell people for the next 50 years or whatever. Wow, let me tell you about this story. This terrible place we went to and this awful stuff happened. I was stuck with this load. I couldn't work. We had a lawsuit because they wouldn't return it, and it ended up going. And I could get a whole movie out of this. A whole movie script is possible to get out of this. A really great movie script. And people listen to the story and laugh and say, "Ah, wow, that's a really great story. That's awesome." You know, disaster story, terrible. And I said, "You know what? I don't want any story. I don't want any storyline at all. I don't want to waste people's time with that." And so I said, I decided this is going to go perfectly. And end of story. Boom. And that's exactly what happened. So now I have this story of how I decided not to have a disaster story and how it all went perfect. And that's a better story, isn't it? It's a better story. So we have this story of how the world's going to go terrible in the world. There's so many who are deciding they want this excuse. Well, we don't have to make this excuse. We don't have to. We can decide, no, you know what? I don't need this terrible excuse. I don't need to go to God and say, God, I was just about ready to change what you are, as you told me to do. At least that's what our story. And son of a gun, some asteroid hit the world. I needed this world to help me out and finish the project. I was almost finished with this project. I needed this world, all these humans, to accept me and accept this project and agree to go along with it. And we're going to implement it here in this world. But then this asteroid came along and hit the world and destroyed civilization and ruined the project. God, I mean, it's just like unbelievable. I can't believe how terrible it was. I mean, gosh, it was so awful, God. So that's why I couldn't complete the project. And then we expect God to laugh and say, wow, Spirit, you know, you'll do better next time. Don't worry, you can bounce back from this. And yeah, that was awful, just terrible. It was awful how those things work. You know, isn't it just amazing? It's kind of mysterious, not really sure why. Well, we don't need that kind of story for God. Because God already knows that this is all complete pretense. That God didn't give us a project to change God. It's whim. It's our own whimsical adventurousness that came up with this nonsense. So, God's not God. We don't need any story to give God about why we failed. So we don't need an asteroid to hit the world. We don't need the collapse of civilization. We don't need any of this to happen, actually. We don't need to suffer through any sort of travail so we can have a story to tell God. So, well, I was still messed up, God, but that's because of the awful travail I went through. You know, if I hadn't gone through that, I'd probably be blissful and happy and everything would be fine. Finish the project. We don't need that. We don't need it. So I'm in a very big wow state today, as every day. Every day brings a new wow to the day, right? Live in the wow. Walk together in the wow. We're walking together in the wow. Walking together in the wow. St. Paul said, well, I die daily. Every day I die and reborn in Christ. Daily, this is the same thing, walking together in the wow. Wow. I just, you know, committed to this. I just let go of that. I made a commitment where I would let the Holy Spirit deal with this very seemingly delicate situation. And I trust the Holy Spirit. Whatever outcome, Holy Spirit, I know it's going to be great. And it's going to help restore my faith in the light. This is what the Holy Spirit will do. And so this is what it did. It did just fabulous. Immaculate. I wanted an immaculate outcome. I got it. Well, I wanted an immaculate positive outcome. I got it. I could have gotten an immaculate negative outcome. So whatever outcome we get, own it. Say, wow, that's great. What an immaculately negative outcome this is. Awesome. Spot on. It's exactly what I wanted to do. Great shape. I'm in great shape now. Because I got exactly what I wanted. How could I not be in great shape if I get exactly what I want every moment? How could I not be in great shape? And this is what Thaddeus Golis was getting at. Maybe I should pay him a visit and thank him. I don't know if he's still with us. I hope so. But maybe he might say, no, I didn't get it right. No, stay away. Like Helen Schuckman says, I wish I hadn't transcribed the course. You know, it was too much of a burden. Oh my gosh, I don't want to be seen as this great, you know, because people pester you. Believe me, as I previous life, I know, being very well known, I don't want people, stay away, you know. They're looking for your autograph, you know. I just don't. I disown my work. So she kind of disowned her participation in it. And the people think that means, well, it couldn't have been right yet. No, that's not true at all, because I haven't been through experience. I wanted to disown my creative work too. I said, I never did anything. Stay away. I'm not who you think I am. Don't stop. Don't bother me. I'm just a pauper. You know, I never did anything. So Helen Schuckman was just like that. She just said, wow, I don't really want to be stuck with all these words, right? I want to go beyond words. So don't stick me with these words. So that's perfectly understandable. We're not sticking her with the words. She's released from the words, because the words that we're saying here is better shorthand, actually. We're getting to you know, great shorthand, you know, so it helps free people from the words. Free from the words. Wow, we're just saying, love it exactly the way it is. This is really great shorthand. And again, how can we be going wrong when every experience we're having is exactly spot on, exactly the way we want it? What could be wrong? What could be wrong? You know? You start looking at it like that, you start saying, wow. So, interestingly, the Holy Spirit said, go back to the 60s. I want to check the publication date of Lazy Man's Guide. Maybe it's the 70s. So, I'm told, certainly go back to pre-computer time, 79. When did Elvis die? I don't know. 76, maybe? Go back to Elvis time. Now, go back to... And then go back to the 60s. Go back to that time. Maybe we did know the truth. And certainly we seem to have the culture of excuse making. As we get closer and closer to this great excuse that's coming up, we've been intimidated by it, because those who want this excuse, they seem to be more powerful because it seems like they're going to have a good story to tell God, like why they failed, and we don't. And so we've sort of backed off and been intimidated. Not sort of. We've been very intimidated, spiritually intimidated. In my life, I've been very spiritually intimidated as we get closer to this big excuse. There's no question about it. So many have dropped off, dropped back. They're in the shadows still. I want to help bring them out of the shadows if I can. I hope this is bringing some out of the shadows. Seeing that someone here is not quite as intimidated as they used to be. I'm not quite as intimidated as I used to be. I'm still intimidated, no question about it. Because people say, are you nuts? You've got this great excuse and you're not going to use it? That's crazy. And I know it's not crazy at all. See, but the overwhelming pressure in the world is that's crazy. Do not use this excuse. You're going to fall behind entirely. Well, how can now fall behind? It's neither can't get ahead, can't get behind. You can't get ahead of itself, can't get behind itself. Now is the kingdom of now is just now. There's no falling behind for the kingdom of now, is there? Yeah, I can try this. I hope it doesn't mess up the video. It hasn't before. I just faith that we've got an hour now. We've covered a lot, haven't we? So what I'm trying to do is help those who've been intimidated. You know, maybe thaw out a little bit. Just say, wow. Let me not give up completely here. Let me think, maybe I don't have to use this excuse. Maybe I don't have to use this excuse. Boy, how I wish I could time travel back to the 60s right now. Good Lord. Oh my gosh. And tell them, hey, this is what's going to happen. This is the pressure we'll be under. There's a way to sidestep this. And in some way, I am traveling back to the 60s. Because I was there, and I was aware what was going to happen because I had such precognition. And I know that this is going to be a great excuse coming. And so somehow, I was able to say, hey, let's not give up on this. Let's not give up our spiritual clarity, even though we know there's going to be a lot of intimidation coming. I'm committed to not giving up on this, and I'm going to bring it back for full circle. And so I was able to survive, somehow. Not thrive, but I'm still here, which is amazing. And we got, let me Google Lazy Man's Guide to Enlightenment. Let me see if I can bring this up. And we're bringing it back to back then, where we were definitely knocking on heaven's door. I think, didn't Bob Dylan do a song, Knocking on Heaven's Door? Something like that. So I'm looking for Google to give me a search page. So we are going to search here. It's working a little slow. Lazy Man's Guide to Enlightenment. Lazy Man's Guide to Enlightenment has a PDF here. Let me do the wiki thing on this. Amazon.com, Wikipedia. Lazy Man's Guide to Enlightenment. Ah, wow. Very cool. 1971. Thaddeus Golis. Let me see if Thaddeus, San Francisco. Ah, he passed away. He passed away in 1997. Son of a gun. Well, thank you, Thaddeus Golis. Wow. Yeah, and he, wow, okay. Well, he's still with us right now. Believe me, brother, you're still with us. Stars a letter for friends. The book began as a mimeographed pamphlet, which Golis handed out on the streets of San Francisco in 1971. Maybe I can go to the streets of San Francisco and start handing out something. It was first published, I don't know about that, though. Well, the book was an underground bestseller, published by Joe E. Casey in 71. And in 1979, it was published by Bantam Books. Okay, so it was an underground bestseller, and then in 79, it was published by Bantam Books. He had the popularity of subatomic physics, and his passion for Eastern mysticism began formulating his personal metaphysical paradigm in the mid-1950s. Interesting. So he started on it prior to the drug time. While living in San Francisco in 69, he decided to publish his first short-run pamphlet, Pleasure and Pain, which would put him in touch with others who share his interest in enlightenment. So maybe So the video did stop, unfortunately, by Googling this. So I don't know how much of this you got, but let me go over it again. Let me walk back this, what I said previously here. Very important that Thaddeus Golis did not get the ideas for Lazy Man's Guide to Enlightenment through drugs. He did not. He started in the 50s as manuscripts, and he was very interested in Enlightenment mysticism. So the best of my knowledge, he did not get it through drugs, but it was intended as a guide, trip guide, for those using LSD in 1969. And he self-published on the advice of Alan Watts and Ram Dass. Let's see. He self-published. He wanted to pitch it in 1970. He resolved to use his background as a copy editor for a women's magazine. So he used to work as a copy editor for women's magazines to pitch his language on a level that casual readers could easily understand. The Lazy Man's Guide to Enlightenment was swift and took place over a few chaotic and sleepless weeks, during which he experienced great pain in his right arm. He would write tirelessly in bursts of prose, which included the first sentence of the published text, "I am a lazy man." Golis later indicated that he never considered another title for his book besides The Lazy Man's Guide to Enlightenment. He quickly distributed photocopies of his text, hoping to receive feedback and offering for others to do with it what they will, but his decision to self-publish resulted from the advice and encouragement of such authors as Alan Watts and Ram Dass. The book was originally entitled A Trip Guide for LSD Enthusiasts. It could be used to guide them psychologically and steer them away from bummers. Golis later said he was stunned to see the general audience got off on it. While waiting for delivery of the first edition, Golis created a list of 200 bookstores, including stores he had visited, a book salesman for Harper Row, and he wrote every store manager, informing them that the book would be available and distributed from People Book. He also visited bookstores in San Francisco, leaving them with consignment copies. The copies would eventually sell out in a matter of days. The second printing of 10,000 copies sold out in 2 months. The Lazy Man's Guide to Enlightenment became a rare public sensation in the Bay Area. It sure did. Wow. So this is amazing stuff here. This man, Thaddeus Golis, he spent 20 years working on his ideas about enlightenment. So he was actually a great, great pilgrim and left us with something that was quite extraordinary. And pushed it through by his experience with bookstores and self-publishing and all of that. How about that? And we're talking about this right now. So again, I'm completely walking back any talk of saying that he wrote this. That I think I got it. He wrote it on drugs, but because that 2 week period of sleepless nights and that. But no, it was a burst of inspiration. But the LSD connection was because it was intended for a guide for people taking psychedelics. So it got hooked into drug culture very much so, the book. But not Thaddeus Golis. He did not write this, as far as I know, because of drugs. He did 20 years of great work on this ahead of time to try to clarify his ideas. So here we are, and I have this experience on the golf course. And Michael Murphy might like this, you know, getting this great, you know, breakthrough on a golf course. This may go down as a story. It really happened. I said, wow, why don't I just start praising every shot I hit? Like, that's exactly the result that I intended it to be. And I did that. And the round went smooth and easy. And it's just, wow, this is all good. And here we are talking about Thaddeus Golis. So, he was in, he published at 71 there, but he was in, I don't know what time he went to the Bay Area. Probably 19, Princeton, been military, corporal, da-da-da-da. Wow, yeah, quite a life. Trying to move to San Francisco. Yeah, not sure. Remained in publication until 1993. I didn't say when he moved to San Francisco, but he was probably there, could have been there in 1969. It certainly seems like he was there in 1970. Yeah. Good. Okay, well. Interesting. Okay. Wow, we're just starting this big wowness right here. Back to the 60s. So he was certainly, didn't say when he wrote the, in a burst of inspiration, let me see. No, 1970. So he wrote it in 1970. Good, good, good. Well, you could say the, 1970. Okay, good. Let's go back. No, right here. It says, while living in San Francisco in 1969, he decided to publish his first short-run pamphlet, Pleasure and Pain. So he was there in 69, for sure, and had these ideas, wanting to publish it, but it wasn't quite the finished copy. So 1969. There's that year again. Wow. Going back to the future. Here we are discovering, by using this wow, walking together in the wow, that we can do this. We can actually do this. And understanding why is it that we have fallen away. Using the gift that I had of precognition, I knew what was going to happen in the future. So something in me was aware that I was going to do this difficult task and go into the future, so to speak, and then somehow help bring it back on course, back on track. Huge wow, just physical quiet is the wow. So when you're in the wow, don't try to find words to express yourself too clearly. Don't struggle with words. I can talk just casually like this. I don't struggle. Don't struggle with words, trying to find precise definitions or put your thoughts clearly, like you're going to write them down or convey them clearly. It's just wow, this is really wonderfully heavy stuff, which is what we're after. The 60s are very, have so much wonderfully heavy stuff. Imagine coming across this book in the Bay Area, Lazy Man's Guide to Enlightenment. I mean, I came across it in a bookstore. There's some bookstores in the Bay Area. Wow. Very wonderfully heavy scene in the Bay Area, the bookstores, with so many metaphysical, spiritual bookstores at that time, springing up all over the place, out of the culture of the 50s and this, you know, military-industrial complex culture. And it's like, look at these books, just, oh my, what in the world is this? Wow. Are you kidding me? Where did this come from? Wow. And this one, I remember, was a huge wow. I read the book, and I wasn't that old at the time. I was out 13 years old, 14 years old. But I understood what I was talking about. I said, wow, this is really heavy stuff. This is amazing. This could be true. But it was so wrapped up in drug culture at the time that I said, this is a problem. I can't go with this. But people did use it to avoid quote-unquote bummers, is when they want a bummer, just love it, love whatever you're seeing, experiencing, feeling, love it exactly the way it is, and say, this is exactly what I want to experience, precisely. Why? Because I want to be an idiot. See, this is what was sort of left out of the book. I think we have greater clarity right now. There's no question about it. We need to use this leverage of greater clarity. We now understand why we want to act like an idiot. It's no longer mysterious at all. The mystery's gone. For me, the mystery's gone. The mystery's evaporating for me very, very rapidly. Let it go. That's great. I'm ready to all mystery to evaporate. My goal is to take all mystery out of mysticism and spiritual path and see it just clearly as it is. And this is way preferable, actually. I'm very tired of mystery and the mysticism. Is finished with that. Really finished with it. So the mystery is just evaporating. So he tried to put it in like into physics and science, sort of, because that was the paradigm at the time. Now I don't feel I need to do that whatsoever. Yeah, we're down the road now of a very advanced spiritual understanding. This is true. This is very true. A Course in Miracles flipped the script on this world totally, really. If you really took advantage of it, as I did, took advantage of the opportunity. I saw opportunity, I seized it. Carpe diem, seized it. 1978, seized the opportunity and said, this is going to flip the script entirely on the world. And so I'm still with it. I was reading A Course in Miracles today, yesterday, heavily just saying, wow, wow, wow. You know, some of it seems a little dated, but the power of it is still there, very powerful. And Jesus says all sickness is a choice entirely because it thinks, we think it's going to get us something that we really want. And it's a small price to pay for it. It's entirely our choice, 100%. As soon as we see it's not going to get us something we really want, we can let it go instantly. And I absolutely believe this is true. I have very strong plausible inference this is true. We can let go of anything instantly as soon as we see it's not going to. It has nothing to do with getting what we really want. We don't need to pay a price to get what we really want. Get what we really want. The Holy Spirit has what we really want. He's paying us. We don't need to pay a price. The Holy Spirit is paying us to experience clarity, to experience bliss, to experience freedom, safety. The Holy Spirit is paying us. It's going to enrich us, give us this impression of vast enrichment. So we feel like we're incredibly rich. Walked into a store, there's this huge picture of George Clooney up there, looking like his perfect self with a little smirk on his face, like, look, oh. And I looked at myself and Mary said, I look way better than George Clooney. Why? Because I'm vastly richer, actually. Vastly richer. And of course, he's trying too hard. He's trying to look a certain way. It's me, I'm just confident. Confidence is a better look than what he has. I can see he's insecure. He says, what happens when my looks go? You know, he's trying to hold this image. You know, and he is just like, hey, I've got it. You know, mystery is evaporating. I'm very confident. It's better. I look better than George Clooney, folks. People say, you sure? I said, George Clooney's better looking older brother. You know, because yeah, confidence. I feel enriched. Enrichment is coming. Isn't that a better look? Isn't that a better look? Of course it is. So we're sitting on a gold mine, actually. I'm sitting on a gold mine. We all are. We all are sitting on a gold mine. We don't even have to mine it. We just have to see it. Just accept it. First, we have to practice praising ourselves. Everything we do is spot on, wonderful, great, perfect, perfectly done. It's exactly what I wanted to happen. And it's a funny thing, in the back of our mind, we know it's true. Like I hit a bad golf shot, I knew I was going to hit that shot. Something told me I was going to hit that shot. Now, instead of saying, what an idiot, why'd you hit that shot? You should hit, say, no, it's like, that's a great idiot shot. I hit it exactly the way I wanted to hit it. But then I said, why'd you want to hit it? I said, well, I was kind of intimidated by the water over there. And I didn't really want to play too well right now because I put too much pressure on myself. I start playing well, but I don't want the pressure. So I wanted to, you know, retain my idiot card. Oh, okay. Yeah, great. I understand. I understand why I never retained the idiot card. Absolutely. That's continuity fear. Wow. And the wow factor. Wow. I said, wow. You've retained your idiot card beautifully. Wonderful. Still a certified idiot. Great. I don't want to lose my idiot card right now. Not quite yet. So look at it that way. Praise yourself. Praise yourself. Praise yourself. I got rid of a lot of cards recently, and tags and baggage things and golf tags. Just get rid of all. Commit. Start committing. I don't have an excuse. I got Pro V1Xs now. I don't got no excuse. I don't have. I could be an idiot if I hit a shot. That's exactly what I wanted to hit. You know, not. I can't say that golf ball. I'm not used to it. I don't like the color. It's not used. You know, whatever. It's not a good golf ball. It's just not behaving the way I want it to behave. No, that's not the case anymore. It never was the case. But certainly, no excuses now. Of course, I can always use the excuse of not playing any golf at all, which I'm doing right now, because it's too cold, it's too miserable, it's all this stuff. But, you know, this is very productive, the way we're using our time right now. And it's funny, there's someone's house that had golf clubs inside the door. I could see them, glass door. And I went there last Wednesday or something, and I said, whatever I see, that's going to be important to look. Just look at it and see. Well, they put the golf clubs outside. So I said, golf is out for now. Golf is out for now. And I took it to heart, and I haven't played since. I realized this was something for me to recognize. Right now, don't play. You know, get ahead of steam, get some momentum going. And it turned out to be perfect advice because it's been freezing ever since. Miserable. It was fantastic advice. I've gotten so much done since then. It's just astonishing. And you can maybe tell I'm on fire with confidence here, which is what we want. We want those brothers in spirit. I use that as a generic term, of course. It includes all of us. We want to be on fire. We want someone's on fire with confidence. We want as many on fire with confidence as possible. Real confidence. We're sitting on a gold mine. Everyone's sitting on this gold mine. And we just say, wow, I'm doing a great job not seeing it. Awesome job not seeing this gold mine. Awesome job ignoring this gold mine. Wonderful job. Impeccable job. It's exactly what I want, to ignore this gold mine right at this moment. So this moment, everything's happening perfectly the way I want it to happen. This is the gist of Thaddeus' goal. Let's say everything's happening perfectly exactly the way I want it. He was going at it from the standpoint of particle physics. Light is particle physics. We're going a little different standpoint of the wow and having flipped the script on this world and universe and bodies entirely. It's just easy for us to go at it now in this way. I missed the 60s, I'm telling you. As ragged as it was, wow. Because none of us were really. I don't think I really want to continue on the scripts of before. We didn't realize that. Well, some of us didn't realize that this technology script would come in and try to co-opt the whole thing. I had awareness, some of advanced awareness. There's trouble coming, and living in Silicon Valley, I saw it up close and was able to struggle with it right directly. You know, right. From the bat, said, uh-oh, here it comes. And there's this feeling that says, I don't really want any scripts, which is a very spiritual feeling. I don't want to define what I am. But ultimately, for us, like the women of that time, a lot of them said, hey, I don't want to be defined at all. And so they had this very different attitude they had then. And ultimately, feminism came on, radical feminism came in, being a very strong political, social, political movement, and co-opted a lot of that. And then technology came along, co-opted. So they got co-opted. But there was a time there. They're saying, just I don't really want any scripts at all. And you know, it's a very different situation, very different vibe. You felt more comfortable, because they weren't trying to tell you had to be script your life to fit their script, which is how it usually goes in this world. The women decide on a script for their life, and then the men have to adapt to that script. I want to be a little Susie Homemaker. Guys, you got to go out in the corporate world and bring home the bacon. That's how. That's your script. Because this is my script, little Susie Homemaker. Four kids and a chicken in the pot. So, but at that time, the young women were saying, you know what? I'm not sure I really want any script at all. Maybe I want to go to India and find a guru. Maybe I don't want scripts. So the men felt that we don't really have to fit in any script either. So we had some breathing room then. Breathing room. Partially had to do with youth, but not totally, because a lot of times youth generations come in, they seem to know exactly what the script they want, and they go right into it. Back then we said, you know what, I don't think we want any scripts. Let's be liberated. Let's be enlightened. Pretty darn difficult for women to go through life that way. Very difficult. So eventually they go into some script. I've been able to try and, you know, stay free of scripts my whole life, but I had to battle every single moment of every single day. And at least appear to have some script, but not really. I still don't have any script, actually. I really don't. I feel just like unscripted, very unscripted. I don't free plan these videos either. Unscripted. It's unscripted. In my life, it's still very unscripted. I feel any moment I could be aware of the gold pile I'm sitting on, and everything could change completely. I'm not even aware of what my script is, really. I don't really, not really attached to any script. So people ask me, what do you want to do? I say, I don't know. I can't plan ahead either. As far as, what are you going to do, you know, for New Year's, what are you going to do? I have no idea. I'll just see when I get there. We'll see how it goes. I really don't have a script. Well, it makes it tough to have friends and have a social life, right? Because everyone's planning everything out. Social planners, we're going to do this, we're going to do this. Me, I said, I don't know. I can't really commit, because I could be enlightened this next moment. I could decide to see the gold mine the Holy Spirit has given all of us, that truly belongs to us, reminding us of what the light really is. I could choose that this instant. This is how I've always feel. I could choose it this instant. So I've always kept this feeling that this very instant, I could choose enlightenment for sure. But if I don't, well, that's because I decided not to. I want to continue to be an idiot for a little while longer, which is that's perfect too. It's all perfect. It's all good. It's all perfect. It's all immaculate. It's immaculately what we want. We're all experiencing immaculately and perfectly, purely what we choose to experience, without any exception whatsoever. And this is what A Course in Miracles re-emphasizes over and over and over for so many different angles. You don't try to pin Jesus down to a script. This is the way He comes at it from many different angles to reinforce. So you have to look at it in a holistic way, instead of like a linear way. Well, Jesus said this. This is what he... Say, no, wait a minute. Maybe he's just coming at it from this angle to help those who need to see it from this angle. It doesn't mean I have to see it from that angle. Maybe I don't, but... And then he'll come at it from another direction. I say, that's what I really wanted to hear. So he's not contradicting himself or being confused. He's just approaching it the way the Holy Spirit approaches it. It's from different angles, gently reinforcing it. Look at it this way, this way, this way, this way, this way. Get plausible inference from it. So there's some parts of A Course in Miracles where I say, that seems a little academic, or it seems a little this way. But then I'll go on to some other paragraph and I'll say, that sounds wonderfully abstract. I like that. So it's all good. I don't reject it, because I understand how, because of our pretense and continuity fear and all that, how it has to happen that way through plausible inference and looking at it in different ways, and not be try to be too pinned down to some scripted way. It needs to be sort of open, unscripted. We don't want to get our spirituality to be scripted, actually. Not too much. But love whatever scripting we do have. I love it the way it is. That he has called us. Now some people, young people, are very keen to get into scripts. You know, we see the people that, okay, they see that, okay, I need to high school, going to college, get the degree, get married, have family, or whatever. They have these scripts. For me, I didn't have any script, really, except I want to, my life is going to be this spiritual pilgrimage, and ultimately I'll help be helpful at some point. But I didn't really have any script exactly how to get there, just be very dedicated to it. So I just sit there on a bench and, you know, nothing to do. I don't know. I'm just observing everyone. I'm just taking it all in. I'm saying this, and just recognize, aha. I said, I've been told this is going to happen, and I see it's happening. So just kind of recognizing the precognition that I had and just say, hey, it's true. It is true. It is valid. And I knew A Course in Miracles was going to come into the world. I knew that Jesus was going to give this great, powerful spiritual book. And then I went to a bookstore, and there it was. I said, aha. See, I was right again. Precognition, right again. So I just been observing this world and saying, aha, right again, right again, right again, precognition, right again. Now there are some very clever liars that trip me up a little bit, but I said, okay, but that too was right again, because I had precognition that would happen too. So, right, precognition, right again. It's always right, actually. The awareness being aware of awareness is always right. We can deny it, but it's always right. I don't want to get this too long. I have to combine the two videos because the last one went off when I Googled Thaddeus Golas, which is fine. So again, the reason why we all sort of have shrunk away from really enlightenment, we have, but except if it's true, we have, is because of this great excuse that we have fashioned for failure to be enlightened, actually, ultimately, but failure to succeed in this project of changing reality that we thought we ascribed to God, as if we have the power to tell God what God has to tell us that we have to do. We want an excuse to the failure, because it's inherent failure, and we don't want to accept that, because we feel then that there's something wrong with us. We don't want to be inherent failures. Well, we're inherent failures to destroy ourselves, that's for sure. So this great excuse is coming, and We're thinking maybe we should use this excuse. Maybe we want to have this in our back pocket in case we turn out to be wrong. And I'm saying, no, we don't need this excuse. We don't need to use it. Therefore, we can sidestep it. Absolutely, we can. This ties into a lot of great spiritual teachings of sidestepping it, troubles, sidestepping troubles. Starting to get cold. I don't want to sap myself of energy here, but so anyway, this has been a great experience to make this video, for sure. Here we are in 2016, more on fire than ever, and saying, hey, wait a minute, you mean we can reconnect with right practice, super effective practice? Yes, we can understand why we got away from it? Yes. We don't need to use this excuse? That's right. Yes, we don't need to excuse. You need to use any excuse, really. But certainly the one that is possibly inferred is coming. All right. So I'm on fire. Let's see what happens next. Very great. That's it for this one.